and people of color. Now understand that I've been talking about our prisons. I haven't even turned to the jails in America, which have 19 times more admissions than our prisons do. And here, the majority of people are presumed innocent. And those of you who think that we got rid of debtor prisons in the United States hundreds of years ago, we have not. Many people are pulled away from their families, pulled away from their children, losing their jobs, languishing in jails because they don't have the money to pay to get out. And the jails are disproportionately full of poor people, people with mental illnesses, and people with addictions. But let me switch for a moment to African Americans and Latinos. We now know that in America, there is no difference in usage of drugs or dealing drugs between the races. In fact, some studies will show young white men have a higher rate of dealing drugs in America. But we now know that minorities are multiple times more likely to be arrested for drug use, arrested for drug dealing, than someone who's not a minority. In fact, African Americans are about 3.7 times more likely to be arrested for drug crimes than someone who's white. I often remind people that the last two presidents admitted to using serious drugs. But yet, we don't see, at least I didn't at Stanford's campus, I didn't see our fraternities being raided for searching for marijuana. They would have found it. And so, being that we have a system that is so profoundly biased and concentrated and focused in certain areas, it is having a massive effect in terms of the racial disparities in incarceration. We now know in the state of New Jersey, blacks make up about 14 to 15%, but African Americans are over 60% of the prison population. The racial disparities in incarceration in this country between blacks and whites are worse than it was in apartheid South Africa. We now have more African Americans in America under criminal supervision than all the slaves in 1850. And so what does this mean generationally for a community when you have so many people being pulled into the system? Well, we now know that children of incarcerated parents, of which there are so many in our country that even Sesame Street now is beginning. Google this tonight and watch with as I did, with tears in my eyes, Sesame Street being that they need to start doing little skits for the children of incarcerated adults. What does it mean to our nation when we have so many people now and so many children that are being incarcerated parents? They have a greater chance now of going to prison, greater chance of having disciplinary procedures, greater chances of experiencing poverty. So we need to have a conversation about who we are going to be as a nation, because there is a different way to go, and it is not just speculation that we know the solutions. There are states in America that are recognizing, because their prison populations are getting so expensive, that they're recognizing that they have to do something about it because they can't afford their prison populations anymore. And so you have states like Texas and Mississippi and Georgia who are doing common sense things that to lower their prison population, and guess what they're finding out is lowering as well. Their crime rates are going down. Because if our justice system is just about retribution, punishment, and harm, it actually will have the unintended consequences of creating less safety, less strength. But if our prison populations are about punishment, yes, but also about rehabilitation, about treatment, about empowering people, then we will see a different result. We know right now that we are losing out at about $50 to $60 billion annually in GDP activity and growth because of the undermining of the economic potential of our ex-offenders. We now know that we could be reinvesting that gross amount of dollars in things that not only lower crime, but empower people to succeed. And so we have to have a question. Who will we be as a country? I've been taking recently to telling people that if I could go back in time to the 1700s and someone could assure me that they would not put shackles on me, that I could have a conversation with our founding fathers and say, would you accept a nation that just on arrests alone, the government taking you and arresting you, that you would have, as we have in America, between 75 million and 100 million Americans now with an arrest record, closing in on one out of every three Americans arrested. If I could say to our founding fathers, would you tolerate a nation where almost a third of the people are being arrested? Would you tolerate a nation that is spending this percentage of its resources, public treasury, on incarcerating its own people? I tell you right now that they would put this as one of their list of grievances in the Declaration of Independence. And so my hope and my urgency in Washington is to join with people on both sides of this aisle, because this is not a Democrat issue. This is not a minority issue. This is not a liberal issue. I'm working with conservatives, with libertarians, with Christian evangelicals to join together to begin to make our criminal justice system just again and have it reflect our values. This is a choice. But as I learned in Washington, D.C., and even in our state house, change does not come from Washington or Trenton. Change does not come from Washington or Trenton. It must come to Washington and Trenton by a community of people that are choosing a different path, demanding it, working for it, making the same sacrifices that were made for other things that we celebrate, like our Voting Rights Act. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator. Let me introduce our panel.